Darles la bienvenida a este primer coloquio del semestre. Espero que se vaya incrementando cada vez más la asistencia porque tenemos muy buenas charlas. Les cedo la palabra a Ana para que ella presente a su niña.
Bueno, hola, hoy va a hablar Pierre Bourdin, él es de Grenoble, en Francia, y bueno, es un colaborador mío porque es un articulito y estamos trabajando. Y va a hablar de invariantes que se pueden construir para flujos que son invariantes de flujos.
To be here in Mexico for the first time in my life, and so I will present old work on three-dimensional vector field and what is called mathematical invariance for vector field. So what is the context? I will first tell you the problem and then speak about the history of this problem. So you are given a vector field. You can assume it is a vector field in the three space or more generally on a three manifold, but if let's say on the three space for today. And well, when you have a vector field, you have a flow like this. So the flow of the vector field is just a function that parameterizes the orbit of the vector field. So maybe I should have put in a picture, but you have a vector field like this. This is a vector field g by x, and so you look at lines, at orbits of the vector field, so this is a line that is everywhere tangent to the vector field. And so if you have a point P here, you have the vector field at P, and what is the flow is what parameterizes these lines. So here, this is phi, and then after time t, we have at this point, which is phi t of P. So the flow is just induced by the vector field. And that's it. So if you have a C1 vector field, then you have a well-defined flow. Okay, so this is just for convenience that we define this. And the main feature that for our talk here is if we assume that we have now a diffeomorphism, say of R3, that moreover preserves the volume. So we have so it means that, well, if you take a ball, the image of this ball is preserved. Okay, I don't know, yes, here, just forget about this. This is for later. Okay, so what I want to say that when you have a diffeomorphism, you can push the vector field by the diffeomorphism, just if you push the points, and then you push the derivative. The vector field is just a tangent vector. You push it by the derivative of your diffeomorphism. So when you have a vector field and a diffeomorphism, you have a new vector field induced by the diffeomorphism. Yes, so this volume-preserving thing is, we can say that the vector field is volume-preserving here when we have divergence equals zero. So this here should go here when we consider volume-preserving vector field. Exactly as for diffeomorphism, you can have volume-preserving or just general. Okay. And so the... Yes. That's strange. Yeah, okay. No, it's the same thing. So the goal of the talk is to associate to vector field some quantity, so which could be a real number or anything, an invariant. And what do we mean by an invariant? It means a quantity such that if you just take your vector field and you transport it by a volume-preserving diffeomorphism, this quantity is invariant. So this is the main problem we are interested in, and we'll see that it's not an easy problem in general, so we would like some quantity that is invariant. So why do we care about this problem? So maybe I will first begin with two examples, so this is the goal. So the first example is, assume that you have a point where the vector field is zero.
Yes.
When you transport then this vector field, it is still zero. Yes. So for example, you can count the number of positions in space where your vector field is zero. And this is invariant when you transport by diffeomorphism. So this is an easy invariant, it's a non-trivial one. This number may be 0, 1, it may be infinite, it depends on your vector field. So this is the first example of an invariant. The second example is if you have a periodic point. So what is a periodic point? It's a point where you come back after finite time. So here the orbit is closed, and after some time, big T, you come back at your original starting position. Yes? So we have a periodic point, and when we push everything by a diffeomorphism, this point is sent on another point, but it is still a periodic point, and so we have some periodic orbit. So if we have a periodic orbit, it is transported by diffeomorphism. So, for example, the number of periodic orbits is another example of an invariant. So these are, the, in a sense, the two easiest invariants, and the question is whether we have other invariants, and we'll speak about this. Okay. So now I will go to the history of this problem to motivate and to understand why we care about such entity. So I will make some. This slide is about the motion of an ideal fluid. So this is a so-called Euler equations. So we are interested in some liquid. So we have U is what describes at position P and time t the velocity field. So imagine you have a fluid, you have the particle, and you describe its speed. Yes. Okay. And so in general, this is one remark that if you look at what happens around you, so you can just, the differential of the field U at a point P can be decomposed, so it's just a 3×3 matrix, and it can be decomposed into a symmetric and a Q-symmetric part. And what we are interested in here is the Q-symmetric part. So if you imagine that P is here, this point, locally, if you imagine that P is like that, locally, the omega describes the rotation, the instantaneous rotation around this point. So, yes, okay. So in general, we can this omega, we can describe it by a certain vector field, which is actually the curl. I don't know whether in English we should say rot or curl. So what it means is that you just apply U, you apply this operator. Yes, and then we obtain another new vector field, which is called the vorticity field. And what this field means is that this field, the direction of this field, tells you the local rotation. Yes. So, and the length of this vector, the intensity of the rotation. So, from this velocity field, we can derive a new vorticity field. Okay. And it turns out that this vector, in an incompressible and viscid fluid, this vector field is also volume preserving. And then we will have a certain notion which we call a vortex filament. So what is a vortex filament? It's just an orbit of this vector field. So it's a line here in green that is everywhere tangent to the rotation of omega. So the physical meaning of this line is really not so clear. I mean, it's just we define arbitrarily this instantaneous rotation. And this is a certain line. And so these lines are interesting for the following reason. So I just recall here the Euler equations, so which are rather old, which describe the motion of a perfect, incompressible, inviscid fluid. So inviscid means that there is no friction. So it's really an ideal fluid. So this is just the incompressibility condition, and this is the infinitesimal version of the Newton laws. So I will not play too much with this equation, but just if you apply the curl to the second equation, so if you apply the curl to U, you obtain omega, so you get a new equations, and actually this can be rewritten in other terms, which is known as the Helmholtz equations, which is this equation. And what this equation means is that the field omega is actually transported by U. So it means that this omega, this instantaneous rotation, is transported by the vector field. In other words, if we denote by phi t the flow of U, which tells you where a particle is sent, then we see that the rotation at instant t is just the image of the rotation at instant zero. So here this is something rather peculiar. If you imagine for the vorticity field, if you have a starting position where you have, for example, one fixed point and everything is moving to the right, then after some times, everybody will move. If you have just a fixed point, if globally people move to the right, then a fixed point doesn't stay a fixed point for the vorticity field. For U, we don't have this property that U is transported by the flow. But what it says here is that omega, so the rotation, is transported by the flow. So this Helmholtz law is really important, and so it was really very nice. And Helmholtz derived several consequences of this property. So in particular, the first consequence is the easiest to understand. If you have a particle where you have no rotation, local rotation at instant zero, when you flow along the Euler equation at time t, there is still no local rotation. So this is the first remark. And the second remark is the most important for us, is that if you take a vortex filament, so what I described before, so you know that all these particles, where they are sent by the flow, so they are sent somewhere else, but they are all still on the same filament. So if you had particles that were in a sense aligned with respect to the vorticity field, they are still aligned. So in particular, if you imagine that here you have one line of the vorticity field that is closed like that, this line is displayed in time, but it is still a closed line. If you have a vorticity line, so some particles like I don't know how to describe this. This is remarkable. Only this can be seen. You know one situation where this happens. So what corresponds to vortex? So what means? If you analyze what is the movement around this particle, you see that, as I said, this means that the other particle locally turn around this one. So locally, what is the movement around? So the green line, the green filament is transported, but locally people rotate around this green filament. So there is one situation when you can see such rings like that. It is when if you are a smoker and you are able to make smoke rings. And what this theorem tells you is that, well, if your flow satisfies the Euler equation, which is not the case, but it's an approximation of this, then this vortex field, if you have something that rotates, it should be preserved. And so this can be seen. Yes. So this can be seen in real life. So we are in Mexico, so you know what volcanoes are. Yes. And so this is here. What is this thing? Is exactly like a smoker, but a huge smoker, that makes a ring. And what it means is that around this ring that we see that we have a large amount of rotation. Yes. So this ring is more or less preserved. It evolves, but it is preserved. And we see that people rotate around it. In a sense, we can visualize this theorem of Helmholtz here with smoke rings. Yes. And there was a second situation where you can see that, well, maybe a little bit less, but this is with dolphins. So this, I don't know if you see it well, but what this dolphin did is that it made a ring of air, yes, and then this ring rotates very quickly, and so it's very stable, and it evolves like that, and the dolphin is able to push it. So of course, here we don't have Euler equation, we just have an approximation of this. We have these rings, so this is exactly like a smoker. And so, of course, these rings get destroyed when the model stops being ideal or things like that, but this works. So this is a huge one. I always think this movie is fake. I don't know whether it's really true, but... they put in a whale. Okay, so this is the situation. Yes, and as I said, there is a third law that is less interesting for today, is that more or less there is a notion of the strength of a vortex filament which is constant. What is the strength? Is that if I take this here, this is the periodic orbit of the vorticity line, so I can look at how much of the velocity field crosses this thing. So you have a disk, say here, and you can look at how much of the vorticity field goes through this thing, and this is also constant in time, so this thing is invariant. So what this means is that the quantity of particles that goes instantaneously through these circles is constant around time. So in particular, if at some point it rotates as I described, it will rotate forever. And so there is one situation that you can imagine. That is this one. If you have two rings like this, say the black and the white, since the black thing should rotate around the black ring, then the white ring should be attracted inside and then go out. Yes, because things are supposed to rotate around this black ring. And then what happens when the white has passed? Well, the white here also corresponds to some rotation of the particles around it. So what happens is that then the black should go inside. Here actually we can also see this. Yes, so this is what we should see. So this is fake for sure. I mean, it's done by computer. But this is the picture we should see if we have two rings of smokes. And actually, smokers sometimes can do things like that, like two rings and the second goes through the first one. Okay, so we understood what happens. And here, someone that can do it in real life. So someone, he's deep in the sea, like a dolphin, and he, well, I don't know, I think. Yes, so this is what is supposed to happen. Okay, so, enough for movies. So these are Hellman's laws. And here's an historical anecdote, but which is, I don't know whether you know it or not, but so, as I told you, the theorem of Helmholtz was 1858, and so the theorem was remarked by Thomson, who is also known as Lord Kelvin, so the physicist. And at that time, the nature of atoms was really unknown, and people were looking for the model. We didn't have the planetoid model yet, and so people were really thinking what could be atoms. And Thomson, when hearing about this Helmholtz theorem, thought that maybe, well, here's what he thought. So at that time, people were suspecting there was a fluid that was everywhere called ether. And so they were thinking maybe, well, atoms and things like that are just some perturbation of ether, some particular motion of ethers. And so, well, why not ether should satisfy some Euler equation or something like that? And then what Thomson suggested is that an atom is a sort of vortex ring in ether. So this was his idea. And it was very, when he proposed that, at that time, it was very popular in England. And so he worked really hard. And so the point is that black vortex rings, they are just, like, all we see so far was just knots. But now they can form a knot, they can form complex knots. And so the idea of Thomson was that the complexity of these knots could reflect the complexity of the atoms. So he had a plan. So this is an example of a knot. And as we said, we saw that the equation by evolve and so on, but the curve do not evolve. So for example, this second curve here is just obtained as the image of this one by perturbation. And the perturbation can get rather complicated. We can have this thing, but it is still the image of this one by continuous deformation. But now, if we take this knot known as the trefoil knot, this one is not an image of this one. So Thomson's idea was that maybe if we have a vortex ring like that, this should be an atom of hydrogen. It's the simplest one. And this one should correspond to helium or something like that, and so on and so on. And the idea that if we understand the complexity of the knots, maybe we can understand the complexity of the atoms. So this was the idea. So this is another trefoil. So it's almost the same, but with the opposite orientation. And here is what is called a figure 8, so maybe this is carbon or something like that. So this was their idea, is Thomson's idea. So just a definition, a knot in the three space is just an embedding of a circle in the three space. So an embedding, it means there is no double points, there is no triple points, there is just an embedding. Then I consider these things up to isotopy, and the point of considering them up to isotopy here in this perspective is that we have seen that the things evolve, but the isotopy type is unchanged. Okay. So then Tate was a student of Thomson, and so together they started to try to attack this plan. It was first to understand the knots, to classify at least the simplest knots. Then to understand a bit series of spectral properties of knots, because we didn't know what atoms were, but people knew a lot of properties of atoms, in particular some spectral properties. So they thought, okay, if we understand well the knots, then we can try to see whether they correspond to atoms. And so Tate, in particular, started to make a tabulation of all possible knots. And so here is the first page, but there are more of them. He started to classify all knots up to isotopy. So basically what this represents is here, this is a trefoil, this is a figure 8, and then it goes on and on and on and on. And Tate spent 10 to 15 years to tabulate, for example, all knots up to 9 crossings, all diagrams up to 9 crossings. And it was not hand-by-hand analysis. And what is striking is that so he published this table of 169 knots and saying, okay, these are all the knots with less than 9 crossings. And it took more than 100 years to check the table and to see that the table was true up to one mistake. There was one pair. There were two diagrams which were defining the same knots, but they didn't remark it. So it was very, it was a long time. So the thing about the theory class for very long, although it was very popular, Thomson would view less in theory 15 to 20 years later. And the problem with this was this one, in a sense. For example, he couldn't reflect in the knots the property of the atoms. For example, the sodium had many symmetry properties, and so he thought sodium should be what is called a Hopf link to a knot linked like that, but then it couldn't work with other atoms. So, well, the analogy didn't work, but it was still a nice theory. Okay, but what was striking is that knot theory remained, and in particular by tabulating knots, Peter Tate made several conjectures that lasted for more than 100 years. The last one was proved in 1991. Examples of conjectures, so this is one of the Tate conjectures that was proven only in 1987 using the Jones polynomial. In that it should consider what is called an alternating diagram. So an alternating diagram is something like we have drawn before. An alternating diagram is something when you alternate up and bottom positions. So you go first up, then bottom, then up, then bottom, then up, something like that. So this is an alternating diagram. And not all diagrams are alternating. For example, if you do something like this, add one thing. This is another knot, and you see that this is not alternating. Here you go on top, and then still on top. And here you go bottom, and then bottom. So this is non-alternating. So what Tate remarked is that many knots admit some alternating diagrams, and then alternating diagrams were much more easy to deal with than general diagrams. And in particular, what he conjectured is that you can see sometimes when you have an alternating diagram, it's clear that it is not the best you can obtain. For example, you have an alternating diagram that is, say, complicated like this. But then you see that you can make a reflection here on the left, and you have the same knot. This is what is called a non-reduced diagram. And the conjecture of Tate was that if you have an alternating link and you don't see anything like that, then this has the maximum possible number of crossings. Like here, this is 3. And actually, these two diagrams, they define the same knot. And here you see that you have 4 crossings. And this one is not reduced. It's not the best you can do. Okay, so this is an example. And the striking thing is that knot theory emerged here from fluid dynamics and then had his own life, but forgetting about this. Okay. So I will just give a second motivation, which is maybe more important for the problem, from the starting problem, which is due to Voltaire and the study of plasmas of plasma in the stars. So this is 100 years after Helmholtz. So the context is still an ideal context, but you study a plasma. So in a plasma you have some particles, so they move with some velocity field here B, here U, and there is a magnetic field which is very strong in the stellar plasma. Okay, and then you have a certain equations. I will not spend too much time. Yes, I'm done. Okay, so you have certain equations, and you have the same property. Okay, I will. You can derive from these ideal conditions the same equation as before, meaning that the magnetic field is transported by the flow. So which means that if you see some orbit of the magnetic flow, it will be still preserved in time. And this is why when you see pictures of the plasmas in very far away stars, like Voltaire did, you see a big regularity because the picture doesn't change too much over time. So this is what, and Voltaire wanted to understand this, and in particular, so the magnetic field is transporting, but everything else changes. For example, the velocity field will change this, and there is, for example, a quantity that is the magnetic energy, so this is which is this thing, and this thing, so it's just the square of the length of the magnetic field, so the intensity of the field. And this magnetic energy, it has a tendency to decrease over time. So the magnetic energy has a tendency to decrease over time, because this is not invariant over time, yes. But the question was, when this magnetic energy decreases, does it decrease to zero or to something different? And what Voltaire remarked is that it cannot decrease to zero, and here is why. So here is just from this equation here, he derived the following remark. So when you have a volume preserving thing like B here, you always have what is called a vector potential. So B is a vector field which is volume preserving, and it has a vector potential, meaning that you can write it as the rotational, the curl of some vector field A. Yes. And if you apply the curl operator to this equation here, you obtain this one, which means that this is the vector product. So which means that dA is transverse to B. And so what you can prove then is that the integral of just the scalar product of these vector fields is constant over time. So A depends, and there was a choice here, but this integral actually does not depend on this choice, and this is constant over time, so this quantity will always remain. Maybe L, A and B will change, but this quantity will remain forever. And now this quantity, this was remarked also by Voltaire, this quantity gives a lower bound on the energy. So by the following process, this is just an integral of a scalar product. So by Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you can relate it to just the energy of this vector potential and the energy of the magnetic field. And then I write a sort of Poincaré inequality because B is a sort of derivative of A. And so you have some Poincaré inequality like this. And so you obtain that this quantity here, which is invariant over time, is always a lower bound for the energy, which decreases over time. So the magnetic energy decreases, but it cannot tend to zero. Yes. And so this invariant here is very important because it gives you some physical information about your system. And now I will come back. And so we define this invariant here as the helicity. And so it's formal definition given by Moffat in 1969. In particular, Moffat remarked that this was really an invariant. Voltaire didn't remark it was an invariant. Moffat remarked it was an invariant. And it's more generally, it's an invariant under volume preserving diffeomorphism. So I will not prove that, but this is the case. If you have any volume preserving diffeomorphism, you can transport everything, and so this is invariant. And it gives lower bound on the energy. So there are two questions. Yes, so B is a general volume preserving vector field. And you can always define this helicity here, and it will be invariant under volume preserving diffeomorphism. So now, there are two questions I would like to address. Is what is helicity? So I gave a definition, but I would like to give some other interpretation of helicity. And the second one is, can we obtain other informations? Because this information is very useful to physicists and people like that. So what is helicity? So here we will give a topological interpretation of helicity. So in general, so as I told you, if you want to choose a vector field A whose rotational, whose curl is B, there are many choices, which corresponds to what is called a choice of gauge. Yes. And for example, one possible choice is given by this formula. So you see B is given. And if you consider this A defined by this integral, you obtain, so first this integral converges, which is not so clear because you divide by something that tends to zero, but this integral exists, and it satisfies the property that the rotational of this thing is exactly B. So why not? We have a formula for this vector field, and so we can rewrite our helicity here as just a certain integral here, over, so we replace here A by this formula, and so our helicity here is something that depends on the vector field B. So what is this formula like? I should also have made a picture for this, but you have a vector field, you have 2 points, x and y. So here you have a certain vector field B of x, here you have a certain vector field B of y, and here there is a third vector, which is just the vector x minus y. So these are three vectors in space, and when you have three vectors in space, you can consider their determinant, their mixed product. You normalize by the cube of the distance here, and you integrate this over all pairs of points in space. And this converges, and this defines the helicity we started from. So this is one formula. Okay. Now the thing about this formula reminds something to people that do math theory, that I will explain just right now, which is the linking number. So I will define what is the linking number of two knots. So when you have, here is one knot, now you can draw a second knot. We'll draw it here. And the linking number will be a measure of how entangled are these two fields. Actually, the linking number is the easiest invariant you can define for knots, but it's also one of the most interesting. So you have two disjoint embeddings, so K1, K2 are just these two knots here. Okay? And now I consider a certain map that I call direction. We just take 2 points in space and define the direction. So when you are on X, where is Y in the sky? Okay, so this is just a map, but you see that this is a map here that will take 2 points here, one on the first one, one on the second one, and that will associate the direction. So this is a map from the product of these two circles corresponding to the two knots into the two sphere. So this is a map from a two-dimensional torus into a two-dimensional sphere. And well, an algebraic topology allows us to define the degree of this map. And so the linking number of these two knots is defined as the degree of this map. Okay, so this is the, in a sense, the most general definition, but maybe we can make it more concrete. How can we compute the degree of a map in general? What we do is that we take a point here, and we see how many pre-images this point has. So here, if we take, for example, the North Pole, this means that we consider when one knot is on top of the other. So a way to compute the degree of this map is to then to take the double points where K2 is in front of K1 and to count plus or minus 1 depending on some orientation. And here is what you can do, for example. So here you count plus when you see this picture, plus when you see this picture, minus and minus, and you add all these signs over the picture. For example, here, if you have this link here, K1, K2, you add minus, minus, plus, plus, and the linking number of these two knots is zero. So this is one way. So this is a combinatorial formula, but it's just a way of computing this degree here. Now a second formula, which is actually older. Oh yes. It's another way of computing the degree is that you take a two form here on this manifold and you pull it back here and then you integrate. So you take the area form here of the two sphere here, you pull it back, and the product of this area form here will be actually this determinant here. So one way to compute the linking number is just to integrate this map form, which is here, over this manifold. And what we obtain for this linking number is this formula, so we have to normalize. So K1, K2 are these two knots, and we integrate here what is dx is the tangent vector to the first knot, dy the tangent vector to the second knot, and then these two terms. So, well, this is the same thing because this is another way of computing the degree here. But the nice thing now is that this formula, well, if now we imagine that K1, K2 are two periodic orbits of the vector field, what do we have? We have that this dx here is actually proportional to the vector field. So we can replace in this formula, we can replace the tangent, the derivative, by just the vector field at that point. So K1, K2, so these are T1 into R3. So K1 of T1 is the point. X is the vector field, so the tangent to this knot, and apply the same formula. And so we have this formula for the Lindy number of two periodic orbits, and we have this formula for the helicity. So this is just the same as before formula. Oh, I forgot the determinant here. There is a determinant here. Okay. And what do we see? We see that this is almost the same formula, except that here we integrate over K1 and K2, and here we integrate over R3 and R3. And so this is a, well, so in a sense, we can interpret here helicity as a looking number of the vector field with itself. Yes? And this can be done more formally in the following way, so there is a theorem. So here is a general construction that is very useful. So here we have a certain vector field. This is the orbits of the Lorentz vector field in R3. So if you start from point P, say here, yes, you can follow the vector field in blue here for a certain time. So you follow, this gives you a certain arc of orbit connecting P to phi T of P. And then in general, you won't come back to your original position unless you have a periodic orbit. But what you can do is to connect here where you are with the original position with a geodesic arc. So in this way, you turn any long piece of orbit into a knot, a closed curve. So this is a general construction. And then we obtain a certain knot that we denote like here, k for knot, x because it depends on the vector field, p is the starting point, and t is the time you follow. So here, if you can, to every point in time, you can associate a certain knot. And here, if you want, so the prop is due to Arnold, but there was a gap collected by Fogel in 2000. So that if you take so a very preserving vector field, as we did before, well, forget ergodic for the moment, in a certain domain of space, then for almost every starting point P1, P2, so P1 is the first point, P2 is another one, we can look at the maximum number of the two knots they determine. So there are two times T1, T2, so we just take these two long pieces of orbits, we close them by a small geodesic here, and these two knots, we have a maximum number, so we have to divide by the length of the knot, and the theorem is that the limit here almost always exists. Yes, and moreover, so now we add the hypothesis that this is ergodic, so this is, in this case, the limit exists and it equals to the helicity. So this is a more precise way of saying that the helicity is a sort of linking number of the vector field. Okay, so this is the theorem. So actually, I just wanted to mention that the theorem is not exactly the first one of this type. I mean, it was built on an older theorem of Schwarzmann, but in a sense that is more technical because it uses homology. So here is the theorem, is that if you have an ergodic volume preserving vector field, so it will be on a three-manifold N that is not R3 because it has some homology. Okay. So but for that, we consider the knot I was speaking about, and we consider its homology class. So this is a certain homology class. So it lies in the homology space of the manifold. Yes. So we consider this homology class, and we do the same thing. We consider the limit when t tends to infinity. Yes. And so what we do, this limit actually we have to normalize it by the length once again, and the limit almost exists for almost all x. So this is in general, and now if you assume that the vector field is ergodic, the limit exists for almost all x and is constant and does not depend on the starting point. But so this was the first example of a non-variant associated to a vector field here. Just it's not in R3, I mean this is another context. Okay. So now what we have seen is that helicity gives some bounds on the energy of the vector field. Yes, if we have a vector field X, the helicity is a topological invariant that gives lower bounds on the energy. And the question is whether we can do better. Because imagine if we have a vector field, so helicity more or less computes how much the vector field rotates. So if it rotates in the one direction here and in the other direction here, in the helicity, these two contributions will cancel, because it's more or less an integral of the rotation. Yes. And so the question is whether we can obtain bounds that will not, where these opposite contributions will not cancel, for example. And so this is a general question that has very few answers yet. So here is one answer, but it's that is due to Friedman and Hay in 1991. So if we start with the formula we had for LCT, so this is the formula we had before, the idea of Friedman and Hay is that so this determinant here, whether we rotate like this or like this, it will be positive or negative. So in order not to cancel this contribution, but decide to add an absolute value here. They define a certain quantity here that is just the same thing as before but with an absolute value. The problem with this quantity is that now it's not at all anymore invariant under diffeomorphism. So when you have something that is not invariant under a diffeomorphism, what you do is that you take the infimum over all diffeomorphisms. And this is something general when you want to define an invariant under some transformation, you just take the minimum of your quantity over all transformation. But this is a cheap thing, and so what you obtain is something that is, in general, if this you can compute, this infimum is very hard to compute. So you didn't gain much. Well, actually, they change a bit, so they don't do exactly this. Here, there is a privileged direction, in a sense, like the vertical direction, and what you do, you average this thing, but it's not very important. But still, this quantity, which is very hard to compute, that's a much better lower bound on the energy. So they defined another invariant, which is in practice almost impossible to compute, but this invariant is a topological invariant, and it gives a better bound on the energy. So this is the situation, and we don't have, today, up today, we don't have better than this. We don't have better than these two invariants here. So now I jump to the last part, whether we can obtain other invariant than LCT using this construction. So what was the strategy with LCT? We had a volume-preserving vector field, and what we did is to take some invariant of the almost periodic orbits, and we take the limit, we renormalize it, and we take the limit. And so here the next theorem, which is due to Gobodo and Gis, it takes a certain invariant here that is sigma, that is called the signature of the knot. So I will not define the signature of a knot, but the signature is a well-defined topological invariant. Basically, you take the knot, you take a certain surface whose boundary is the knot, you play with this surface, you associate a certain quadratic form, and the signature of this quadratic form is an invariant. You are happy. Okay, I will not spend too much time on defining these. But then they prove exactly the same theorem, that there is a knot here that exists for almost every p, and that does not depend on p. So taking another invariant and linking number, they played the same game, and they obtained an invariant. But the proof here is not at all trivial. It's much more complicated than for linking number. But the sad thing is the following. Yes. That actually, this limit here is actually proportional to the helicity. So there is just a constant here, c, that only depends on the domain, so not at all of the vector field, such that this invariant that we call the asymptotic signature, so it's the signature but asymptotic, is actually proportional to the helicity. So you have a signature is very different from linking number. When you have a certain link, you have the linking number on one side, you have the signature, they don't have anything to see. But the theorem here is that if now if you take longer and longer piece of a vector field, they tend to be the same thing. So you have a very rich invariant here, but actually four vector fields is much richer than the linking number. So this theorem is beautiful for the first part, but sad for the second part because there is nothing new here. And this thing culminated in 2012 with a theorem of Bader and Marché. So signature is a very rich topological invariant of knots, but it's not at all the most complete you can imagine. What the knot theorists like a lot is what is called Vassiliev knot invariant. So Vassiliev knot invariants are a very general family of invariants. Conceptually, electron knots can be distinguished with a Vassiliev invariant, so they are supposed to be a very rich family of invariants. Yes. And we can play the same strategy. So a Vassiliev invariant has a certain order, n, which is an integer. And the theorem is that if you put the same value, so you take an almost periodic orbit here, you take the Vassiliev invariant, you normalize by the length of the orbit to the power 2n, where then is the order, then you have the limit for almost every p. So it's the most general theorem you can hope in a sense, because it takes a very general family of invariant, and you have a limit, very good, But now the sad thing is that the limit is still proportional to the helicity. So this is a very strange situation. We have very rich families of not invariant, but when you evaluate them on vector fields, they just become all proportional to helicity, to Milking number. So this is a rather sad situation. And well, this problem is beautiful, but the situation is sad. And in a sense, it was given an explanation 2 years ago. So I will try to explain quickly this explanation. Why is helicity more or less the unique one invariant? Because it's the unique one which has nice properties. So here, we denote by x the space of all knots, all vector fields, the volume preserving vector fields. And so we imagine that we have a certain function r, so an invariant of vector fields, which is a real number, and which is C1, which means that if you have a one parameter family of vector fields, then this invariant varies in a C1 way. So imagine that you have such an invariant. You say that it is regular integral invariant if you have two properties. So first, you want it to be invariant, which means that if you have a volume-preserving transformation f, this is constant, this doesn't change. And the regular integral means that if you derivate this invariant with respect to your vector field, so as I said, if you have a one-parameter family of vector field, this invariant varies in a serial sense. So it means that if you have this invariant at the vector field x, and you add a small vector field y to x, you can compute the derivative. Yes. So this is what happens when at x, you add the small vector field epsilon times y. You look at what happens. And what they ask, what is asked here, is that derivative here is just obtained by integrating a certain kernel that depends on the vector field. So this is, well, this is a very natural condition. For example, helicity satisfies this condition. And so the theorem is now is the following, is that, so I will explain this, is that if you have a regular integral vector field invariant, then it is actually a function of helicity. If you look for a nice invariant that in a sense admits an integral formula, then it should be helicity. So if you want other invariants, you should look for invariants that are not too regular. This is the story. Okay, so here there are two names, because actually Kudryavtseva is a Russian mathematician, and she proved the theorem 10 years ago in some special settings, and then these three Spanish guys, Encisco, Peralta Salas, and Torres de Lizarro, proved it in another context. So the contexts are not exactly the same, but the main statement is the same. So the philosophy of the theorem is not the same, but the technical hypotheses are not the same. So this is why I put both names. Okay, so this theorem explains the two theorems we had before, because in a sense, well, it's not clear, but yes, here both invariants, they should be very regular, so they have to be proportional to helicity. Okay, so I will just finish with a bit of self-promotion, because so here, in a sense, the question of very regular invariant is closed, but you can still look at some invariants that are less regular, and so you wonder whether you can construct some invariants that will still be interesting, but not satisfy this property. And here is what we did with Anna Rechtmann 2 years ago. So here is another not invariant. This is just a good opportunity to present a nice not invariant, which is called the trunk. So the trunk is defined as follows. Imagine that you have a knot in the free space like this, and now at the horizontal planes. So the horizontal planes that cut your knot in several points, in general a finite number, if your knot is in generic position, it cuts in a finite number. And for every height, you can look at how many points there are. So on top, there are these 0 points. Then at this level, there are 2 points, then 4, then 4, then 2, and then 0. So for a given curve in the three space, you can associate here this thing. And so you can look, so for a horizontal plane, you can look at this plane with respect to your curve, how many times they intersect. Yes? And now you can define the trunk of the curve, just this curve here, as the maximum of all these numbers. So for this curve here, this maximum is 4. So here, if it's an invariant under isotopy to perturb the knot, will this number change? Of course it will, because for example, you can add some riddles here, and then the knot will intersect many times a level. So in order to make an environment, you use the cheap trick I explained. You just take the minimum over all curves that are isotopic. So you define the trunk of the knot to be the minimum over all curves, all deformation of your knot of these things. So it's a sort of minimax, because it's a minimum over all knots for the maximum over all height. So this is a knot invariant. By definition, it's a knot invariant. It admits another definition where you don't change the curve. Here you change the curve. Here you fix the curve, but you change the function, the height function. So you just ask to have a loss function with one minimum and one maximum. It's just the same thing. It's not so important. Okay. But now the thing is that this definition is rather easy to translate to vector fields. Well, we have a minimum over all diffeomorphism, so this is not a problem, and then we have a maximum of the intersection of the knot with the horizontal level. So we can just translate this definition to a vector field, yes, except that we have to say what is the measure of the intersection between a surface and our vector field. And so this is the definition. If we have a certain vector field, so we just copy the definition, but we just have to measure. If we take a certain level, this is a level, what is the measure of this level with respect to x, to the vector field? And here is the proposition, so how to define the measure of a surface when we have a vector field. Yes. And the proposition is the following: if you have a piece of surface and a vector field, you can always push the surface a bit along the vector field, and then you have a volume between these two. And so you can take that volume, so this is just the volume occupied by the surface for time epsilon, when you fluid for time epsilon. If you divide that by epsilon, there is a well-defined limit, and this will be the volume of a surface. So it measures how much of the flow crosses the surface, and actually this is something that is rather well-known by some people. It admits an integral definition, but it's what is called known as the flux of the vector field through the surface. So it's exactly what we have seen is in Helmholtz's third law, that was going through the disk, it was exactly this quantity. So, and this is, in a sense, the analog of the number of intersection points. Now we don't have anymore a discrete thing, we have a continuous vector field, and this is an analog. And so we define this thing, okay, we can always put this definition, and by definition, this is an invariant. And so the theorem that makes this a bit less trivial is that, so we have this thing. If we take a sequence kn as before of long piece of orbits, we can compute the trunk of the associated knots. So we have some, so these are some periodic orbits of the vector field. And we ask that they tend to the volume in the sense of measures. Yes. And the theorem is that then if we take the trunk of these knots and we normalize it by the length, then this tends to the trunk of the vector field. In a sense, we have here an invariant for the vector field that admits a closed definition, and that is the limit of a knot theoretical invariant. And it is not so hard to prove that actually this field is not proportional to the helicity. So it's just to compute it on a collection of examples where we can compute helicity and trunk, and we see that it's not the same. So in a sense, this invariant actually, well, to be honest, this invariant, the trunk of knots, is not at all easy to compute. It's only computed on a few examples. So this invariant, on the knot theoretical side, is not so interesting. I mean, it's interesting, but it's very difficult to compute. And so here we have another invariant, so we don't claim that this invariant is easy to compute. But at least it's not proportional to helicity. So the question we are thinking about is whether this invariant could give a lower bound, another lower bound on the energy. We'll finish with this. Thank you.
Proportional, but it's not a function of
helicity. No, yes, I should have said it's not a function of helicity, yes.